broke into the pop mainstream with a fractured cover of George Michael's Faith, turning this band of nobodies from nowhere,
we're dorks from Jacksonville,
into actual rock stars.
Being a rock star is what life is about.
Now, however, Limp Bizkit has a second album to flog, and the question is, are they here to stay, or are they just part of a passing rap metal trend?
I don't think that we're a fad. I think that we're part of a fad. I think that we could go past it, and I think that we will.
But can they ever resolve their never-ending internal squabbles?
Wes will get pissed off and think that sucks, and then I'll go, no, that sucks, Wes. You know, that sucks, man.
And can the rock and rap friends who weigh in on their new album help turn it into a significant hit?
Hell yeah.
Yeah?
Ultrasound, Limp Bizkit.
I was that guy in like seventh grade. I remember like wearing a Michael Jackson jacket and like breakdancing and liking Michael Jackson. And liking like Rat and Kiss and all these other bands, you know, and I was such a reject. No one could accept that I like black music, what they call black music, and I like rock music.
Psycho female blowing up the phone line. You need to tighten that screw, it's been loose for a long time.
An aspiring tattoo artist from Jacksonville, Florida, Fred Durst grew up torn between two generally segregated styles of music.
Sugar Hill Gang, Eric B. and Rakim, and then I just started liking like hardcore, like Suicidal Tendencies.
Durst found a future bass player in skateboard fanatic Sam Rivers.
I think I met Fred in the mall. I was working at Chick-fil-A. I don't even remember how we started talking, and all of a sudden we were like, you know, let's get together and jam. And I knew a couple other people, and we started some weird, freaky, dumb band.
Rivers had been inspired to become a musician by his jazz-loving cousin, drummer John Otto.
But all I can tell you is it started right here, baby. Right here.
Together, they joined forces with Durst in 1994 to form an early version of Limp Bizkit.
We're a three-piece, and I was playing guitar and rapping, which I can't play guitar. And so I had everything tuned to one string, so I can just go, you know, one. I was like, you know, one stringer, you know, and all the songs were like really whack. I mean, you know what I mean? But it's like, there was this vibe.
Guitarist Wes Borland, who hailed from Nashville, was maybe the unlikeliest candidate to hook up with the band that would one day become Limp Bizkit.
Oh, we hated each other.
Yeah, I was working at a coffee house, like late night coffee house, jazz club type place, as a bartender, and he came in and was like, hey, so blah, 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 and I went, because there's all this crap about bands talking crap about each other, and I heard you say my band sucks.
Wes was in this other band, and I was like, we should get him. And everybody's like, oh, he's the biggest asshole in the world. And there's no way that guy, I mean, he just da-da-da. So I go, well, I got to go to Philadelphia. And he goes, while I'm gone, talk to Wes and see if he'll do it and see if we can't put this band together.
If he was in town, I would have showed up and realized he was a dead immediately and not, you know, not join the band. So good thing he was in Philadelphia.
So the night of the show, I came home and met Wes. Like, that was Limp Bizkit's first night, was the night of a show.
The four of them spent 1995 playing around Jacksonville, a city from which the big time can seem very far away.
We were all like ready to hate each other. We're like, man, this sucks, man. Nothing's gonna happen, you know, and then I met Korn. Are you
ready? At the time, Korn was just another scuffling band, but they did have a record deal, and they seemed to be spearheading a new movement towards super heavy rap-inflected rock. Durst, eager to make influential friends, invited Korn back to his house to demonstrate his tattooing skills, which turned out to be not all that impressive.
And he gave me some whack-ass tattoo on my back.
Yes, Nora on his back.
It's gonna say Nora says Nora.
So I did that tattoo, and they just stayed in touch with me, and we handed him a demo with Counterfeit, Pollution, and Stalemate on it. And next thing you know, we're getting a call from Ross Robinson. Oh my God, Ross Robinson produced the Korn record. He's calling us, holy crap, you know what I mean? So Ross was hooked up with us, and we're like, man, something's gonna happen here.
And something did. Out of nowhere, the white rap act House of Pain booked Biscuit as the opening act on a short Florida tour. And the band quickly bonded with House of Pain's DJ Lethal.
It took me around Jacksonville and just around Florida and just became friends. And then I had to go on the road with House of Pain. And then by the time I came back, we pretty much broke up House of Pain. And I just jumped in the studio with these guys.
Right at that time, we went through this huge argument in the band. And I kicked out Wes.
Yeah, we were about to sign a record deal, and everybody got all just completely at each other's throats. Fred and I both just not getting along at all, and I was bullheaded about a lot of stuff. I have attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, and I take legal speed Dexedrine 10 milligram Spansels for it, and I quit taking them for a week. And I'd never gone without taking them before and didn't know that I was going to become a bad, bad man.
And it was just a war. And then we broke up, and it was like, I was like, man, that doesn't matter. I'll find another guitar player because we're a band. We're going to record a record anyway. And we tried to make it work, and it was bad, man. It was like real bad.
It wasn't the same as like the demos I heard. And I was like, no, we got to get Wes back.
So I was begging Wes all the time. I was going, Wes, please. And he's like, no, man, I'm not doing it.
I wasn't ready to go yet. I think I had some personal issues to resolve before I went and off and became a rock star.
Stardom's a potent lure, though. Wes finally returned to the fold, and the band went in a studio and slammed out its debut album, $3 Bill, y'all.
We weren't even thinking we were going to sell any records. We didn't give a shit. We just were like, hey, let's go on tour, and let's... Korn wants us to go on tour. Wow, we got to make a record. We're going to be, so let's just make a record.
Still, it took a year before Limp Bizkit started breaking on the band's first headlining tour called Ladies' Night in Cambodia.
That tour, I think, and with all of us, set up a little spark. And it was kind of like the opening of what we saw, what could be the future.
And this is really going to tell us if people like our live thing, if our band sucks, really if what we're doing is coming off or not.
They were there for us, and that was unbelievable. That when we have fans calling us by our name, going, "Hey, Wes," and I'm like, did he just say what? That's really weird.
It was just like a dream come true. I mean, not everybody gets to experience that, and like, all I can say is become a rock star, man.
Limp's budding stardom suddenly soured, though, when the media got wind of the fact that the band's record company had openly paid money to an Oregon radio station to play the group's single, Counterfeit.
There's so many people that pay radio stations to get their song played because maybe they can't get it played in this market or it's a tester. And coincidentally, Limp Bizkit did it one time. And so all of a sudden, we're on the New York Times, and we're the worst band in the world, and we committed this big crime. Well, it didn't kiss my ass because it worked.
The payola story may have been bad press, but it was press. And together with a growing underground buzz, it helped build concert demand for the band. A further boost came with the group's slot on the Ozzfest tour in the summer of 98, and its subsequent bust-out stint on Korn's Family Values tour, where the rock multitudes were first exposed to Limp's twisted take on outright pop.
Well, I guess it would be nice if I could touch your body. I know not everybody has got a body like me.
When we started doing it, it was just like a, wow, it'd be really cool to do this song, like put the Limp Bizkit touch on this George Michael song in the band. I came in one day and the band was like, the hell are you talking about, man? We're gonna do Faith? I go, trust me, man, we'll do a kind of beginning, kind of cheesy like he did it, and then we'll just bang, and blow it up.
Rock, gotta have faith! Gotta have faith! Gotta have faith! Gotta have faith! Get the fuck up!
Prince's explosive version of Faith became the first actual hit off the band's $3 Bill album, and soon the group was all over MTV and Radio 2. These developments, however, struck a lot of original fans as a craven sellout.
It baffled me how mad everybody got, how mad our fans got, to where I'm in the internet go into our websites. Limp Bizkit sucks. I hate all of you. You are mine. You are my band. I can't believe you. Sell out. Dead bastards. Fred gets on my nerves like you won't believe.
By the end of 1998, 2 years after its release, Limp Bizkit's $3 Bill album had sold more than a million copies. But even though the cover of Faith was still a happening track, the band decided its fans were ready for a refill.
Our old fans have been, you know, having the same old record, so we got to give them something new.
Now the pressure was on. Could the band come up with an album that would boost them into the ranks of actual rock stars? Or would they blow it and be consigned to the junk heap of one-shot has-beens?
Your second album is your most important record, no matter who you are, you know? Period. You know, that's what solidifies you in the public sense.
The band decided to get right to work, which meant that any plans for a much-needed break had to be abandoned.
We went on tour for like 2.5 years with no break. I went home for one day to go grab a few things that I would need, get my wife, and just went right into pre-production.
Songwriting panic set in pretty quickly. What if they weren't as good as their fans thought they were? What if they weren't as good as they thought they were?
Everybody was so tense, like, does this new stuff suck? I mean, are we really lost it? Because it didn't sound like the first record, right? We're like, I think we might suck now.
Wow, you know, it's gonna be really hard to write these songs that are better than, you know, Counterfeit. And we're going, what are we gonna do? And then all of a sudden, bam.
Show me what you got. Limp's budding success hadn't much eased the group's interpersonal tensions, though, and songwriting proved to be a knotty process.
I'm so stupid when it comes to writing. And Fred gets on my nerves like you won't believe.
Wes will get pissed off and think that sucks, and then I'll go, no, that sucks, Wes. You know, that sucks, man. You're sorry, dude. And he's like, oh, he gets mad, and this and that. The next thing you know, 30 minutes later, we're at this really cool point where it's really fat.
That's how much we care about what it sounds like. We're not just, hey, this is cool. Let's write a song. Oh, they'll love it. You know, we're like, it's not good enough, it's never good enough. And then all of a sudden it is good enough. And we go, oh, I love you, man.
On the other hand, some of Limp's new songs happened as if by magic, like Nookie, the new album's first single.
I don't even know how that song happened. It was like it was an accident.
We have like three.
Fred like bailed on us one day and he's like,
dude, write a hit.
We're like, oh great, okay, I'm gonna write the best thing I ever wrote right now. But I don't know, we're just like, oh whatever. Alright, let's just play something. I loaded up that drum loop and then like, cool, let's start with that. I think about the day my girlie ran away with my babe. When fellas came to her play,
now she's stuck with my homies that's home. And I'm just a sucker with a lump in my throat. Nookie, not surprisingly, is about the carnal torments Fred Durst underwent with an ex-girlfriend.
That song is about a girl that I went out with for a long time, and then while I was gone on tour, she had decided to sleep with my friends and become very promiscuous, and I kept going back to her, you know, and I can't understand why I would do this, you know, and I think about it now, I think I did it all for the nookie.
It's no good when all that's left is the sex.
You know, I've probably went on this no sex binge of mine. I even have a song, No Sex, that I'm just not practicing anything like that, you know, until I know, I think it's gonna be looking for the soulmate. Should've left. We've calmed down a little bit, and we figured out what works, and we're also going out on another limb with a lot more melody. Songs are so melodic and so like on another level for us.
Not that they've turned into the Backstreet Boys or anything. The old Limp Bizkit lives on a ferocious new track called Break Stuff. Break your f***ing face!
face tonight.
Break Stuff is about one of those days you just wake up and you got to break something. I mean, it's just those days, stay away from me because this is not my day.
Break Stuff was more of an idea that had no song to start with.
We were like, man, this song has to be that one note, super simple, mega. Anybody can pick up a guitar and play this song. One of those fun songs, one of the songs you really feel. And like, it was so hard to make something that simple. I think you better quit talking
that. Come and get it. That shit is crazy, right? Oh man, it hurts my feelings.
I'm sitting right here with Method Man, you know, writing a rap. You know what I mean? Like, we're getting ready to rap together. You know, what if he thinks I'm a buster? Like, just some whack ass white guy wannabe.
In recording Limp Bizkit's second album, Significant Other, Fred Durst called in some guests to help out with the vocals, among them one of his all-time rap idols, Wu-Tang Clan star Method Man.
You know, I love Method Man since the day I heard his voice, and I was just like, oh my God, man, I'd love to hook up with that guy. You know what I mean? Next thing you know, we're at MTV on New Year's, and you know, I say, hey, Fred, I want you to meet Method Man. And I just, he's like, hey, you know, man, I love Limp Bizkit, you guys are fat. I'm like, what? I was like, man, we gotta do something together. He goes, dude, I'd love to. He just comes in, he's like, what's up? Gave me a big hug. And he's like, Wu-Tang, Limp Bizkit, man, we're gonna rock that. I'm just like, and he goes, I'm gonna go start writing my rhyme. And so I had to sit down right beside him and start writing my rhyme.
Thank God I'm blessed with the mind that I reckon. Wait until the second round and knock him out.
They call me Big John Studd, my middle name Mud. Dirty water flow, too much for you thug.
We're getting ready to rap together. You know, what if he thinks I'm a buster? Like, just some whack-ass white guy wannabe, has no flow, no swing. Dude, and I really would be hurt if he thought that. But I really felt like I could come to the plate with something.
Wu-Tang and Limp Bizkit, roll on the set, kick a hole in the speaker, pull a plug, and then jet.
With the new album's rap cameo covered, Limp Bizkit reeled in another guest from the rock side, fallen Stone Temple Pilots singer Scott Weiland. Durst and Weiland got hooked up by a mutual friend one day over a power lunch in L.A.
I'm sitting with him and I'm just acting cool, you know, because I can act. So I'm just like, hey, what's up? You know, no big deal. I'm eating shrimp, you know, I'm tripping out. I'm eating Scott Weiland. I said, man, you should hang out. I got some melodies and I'm singing, man, and I really don't know if it's good or if it sucks, man. I mean, I think it's good, but so I did what I did, and he just sort of hung out and was like, dude, it's good. You know, and to have Scott Weiland tell me it's good really helped me be confident in my singing. Jonathan Davis was coming in to do something with me, and all three of us were in the same room, and I introduced Scott and John, and we just picked out a song and just started writing, all three of us on a piece of paper.
If Durst was excited about working with Scott Weiland, the addition of Jonathan Davis of Korn, on whose album Durst had previously made a guest appearance, put him pretty much over the top.
It's another thing that I thought would have never, a year ago, would have never thought would be happening, and it happened. And Scott Weiland's on the record, Jonathan Davis.
I lay my life on the line.
With the Significant Other album completed, Limp Bizkit now has to take it out on tour, which shouldn't be a problem. After all, they say, these new songs were made to hit the road.
The whole thing about this record was, for all of us, was to go and make a live record. Something that is going to be right there, it's all ready to go. It's the perfect tempo.
We definitely know we got to go back on tour, and we got to spend a lot of time on tour. And it's definitely that record. It's all about the live performance.
And about keeping the fans involved, which is why the band invited a bunch of them to appear in the video for the new single, Nookie.
Oh, this is a great idea. Every band should be doing this. In fact, I'm insulted that more bands aren't.
Limp Hank also staged three guerrilla shows to stir up some frenzy about the new album's release.
Show up, set up in an alley or on a building rooftop and play. And just take over the place until the cops shut it down.
You know how we do it!
Limp was concerned about reconnecting with fans who hadn't seen the band play in more than 8 months, and with those who may have come to resent the group's steady ascent into the big time.
We're a fan base band, and as the base gets bigger, there's going to be fans that might not get as much attention.
They tell me that I'm a bastard for selling out on MTV. You guys were doing fine just touring. Oh, you think, huh? You think I was, you know, all my bills were covered and everything, huh? Think I like being in your town three nights a year?
Our feet are on the ground is probably more than a lot of our fans' feet are on the ground. And one thing we are is we are fans. We're fans that got lucky enough to be on the other side of the barricade.
Fame, you're claiming is the top of the world, but the stage I'm claiming is the top of the world. And love, I'm feeling when you people connect. And if you're out in the crowd, you're getting more than respect. And if you're wondering, I got plenty of flows, I'm making plenty of friends and many of foes. But as the audience grows, security knows, stopping me now, it's kinda serious. No use in dreading what they call Armageddon. I think we made it through the slump. It's like